Hello, I'm Judith Dolkart, Deputy Director for Art, Education, and Programs at the DIA. I'm happy to welcome you to a short video tour of Experience and Expression, an exhibition that explores recent acquisitions of contemporary works that have entered the DIA's collections over the past 10 years. The works in this show demonstrate the DIA's mission to collect and present works by artists of diverse backgrounds and cultures, sharing the individuality and universality of experiences, ideas, and concerns around the world and at home. To create the art of our time, artists often draw on their own experiences of the world. This installation has been divided into three sections, which explore the use of abstraction and figuration, the experimentation with traditional and novel materials, and the definition of self and others. The works in this exhibition invite you to look closely, to ask questions, and to connect with your own experiences. Please join my colleagues and me as we explore a small selection of what's on view.
Hello, my name is Megan DiRienzo, and I'm an interpretive planner at the Detroit Institute of Arts. As an educator, a common question I hear about abstract art is, what does it mean? What was the artist's message? And the answer isn't usually straightforward. Abstract art is often about evoking an experience, something that can't quite be put into words. So another way to approach abstract art is to ask this question: what am I experiencing as I'm looking closely at this work of art? Follow curator Jill Shaw as she explores the abstract styles of Philip Guston.
Hi, I'm Jill Shaw, Rebecca A. Boylan, and Thomas W. Sidlick Curator of European Art from 1850 to 1970 here at the DIA. Here in the first gallery of our Experience and Expression installation, I'm especially excited to show you large works in this gallery because they embody the way artists create alternate worlds and experiences and environments and allow us to peer into them using our eyes and imaginations to piece together stories. The first painting I want to turn to is this one by Philip Guston called Arrival from 1965. When I first look at this painting, I'm immediately drawn to the beautiful surface the artist has created with his very gestural and active paint application. But the more I look at the painting, the more I begin to focus on the distinct shapes that have their own sorts of personalities. Of course, this monolithic black square made out of twisted brushstrokes pops out first. Is it covering something up? Or is it a window of sorts that pulls us into the belly of the painting? And then I'm struck by the other colors that we see, especially along the edges, the blues, the yellows, and especially the pinks that emerge. In Guston's representational paintings, his human figures are often pink, so perhaps this painting began as something different. I wonder if maybe there used to be a giant human head and that we are seeing the top of it here. We can't know for sure because Guston covered it with his gray and black paint. But I love the mysteriousness of this work and the beauty of the slathered and layered paint which creates a complex tactile surface. I'm now going to turn you over to curator Valerie Mercer, who's going to speak about another artist in the installation who plays with abstraction.
Hello. I'm Valerie Mercer, curator and department head of the Center for African American Art. I want to speak to you about the abstract painting Plum Nellie, painted by Robert Reed in 1972. Plum Nellie measures 7 feet by 8 feet, and the medium is acrylic on canvas. It's constructed as a diptych consisting of 2 right-angle canvases abutted to each other to form a triangle. Plum Nellie belongs to a series of paintings developed by the artist in the early 70s. The series name emphasizes its dominant color, which is a deep purple. In a 1986 interview, Reed stated that the title Plum Nellie was inspired by his initial mixing of purple paint. At the time, he thought the color wasn't right, but it was close. The expression Plum Nellie came to mind. According to him, it's an old Southern idiom meaning almost or nearly there. Plum Nellie displays a combination of geometric elements with gestural, painterly forms activated by the force of color. Purple and bright green or turquoise are applied in neat visible splatters and swipes of a wide brush and intersected by sharp-edged white rectangles. The tension conveyed by the contrasting elements and forms are complemented by the array of textures he created by applying paint in various ways. For example, flat matte areas of black paint are juxtaposed with areas of unprimed canvas and areas where a glaze has been used. Like many abstract artists working during the late 1960s and into the 1970s, Reed's art from this period expressed his reaction to the constraints of the prevailing minimalist aesthetic, characterized by mechanically drawn geometric forms and the removal of the painter's brushwork through techniques that produced a flat and smooth finish that make the painting appear to be made by a machine. About the Plumnelli paintings, Reed said, "I fell in love with purple. It was regal, it was deep, and I enjoyed it as a color and began to use it because it completely changed my act of painting."
The artworks we just explored were created with paint, that stalwart material artists have used for centuries. But there are no limits on the materials contemporary artists use to express themselves. In this exhibition, you'll see artworks created with old electronic parts, thread, and even remnants from an old apartment. When artists transform these materials into works of art, the materials are imbued with new meanings. Join curator Dorota Chadzika and consider, what thoughts and associations do those materials evoke for you?
Hello, I'm Dorota Chadzika, Assistant Curator of Modern European Art at the Detroit Institute of Arts. I'm first going to explore with you a work by Gada Amer titled Black Absence. In Black Absence, Gada Amer reinvents the language of painting by using thread and embroidery on top of it. For centuries, embroidery traditionally has been regarded as a feminine and domestic activity, and it has been seen as a leisure interest, a hobby confined to a private sphere. By incorporating embroidery in her work, adopting a needle as a tool in place of a brush, Amer challenges the boundaries that divide art from craft, the public from the domestic, the masculine from the feminine. Black Absence is embroidered with several definitions of absence taken by the artist from dictionaries. Additionally, strings of long threads are secured onto the surface with the gel medium to reinforce the horizontal rows of words. At the same time, the threads obscure the individual letters, moving the text in and out of focus, making it difficult to read or absent. A close viewing is required to decipher the text. The illegibility of text, in effect, questions the clarity of written language and undermines its authority. The title suggests that the canvas is black, but up close, the richness of color is revealed, with traces of green, ochre, and red underneath the black surface.
Identity. Who we are, who you are, who I am. How do notions of gender, sexuality, culture, nationality, and race shape how we experience the world? How do you express who you are and define yourself? Many artists in this exhibition explore those questions using realistic representations, abstract styles, or unconventional materials. For the final segment of our tour, Deputy Director Judith Dolkart will examine artworks by artists who use everyday objects to evoke and explore identity.
In this painting by Ernan Bass, a fictional auction house intern catalogs Andy Warhol's possessions for sale after his death. We see mundane cookie jars, rare antiquities, and modern paintings. This mix tells us a lot about Andy Warhol's broad interests. And when they were sold after his death, they became highly desirable because they had been owned by one of the giants of art. I hope you enjoyed this short exploration of experience and expression. There's so much more to see in the galleries. I hope you'll join us soon at the DIA. To visit, timed reservations are required. Visit dia.org to order tickets, which are free to residents of Wayne, Oakland, and Macomb counties. We ask that all visitors wear masks, and we'll take your temperature before entering the building. Stay safe, and we'll see you soon.